Welcome to St. John's. We are delighted that you are joining us for worship this day. Our service begins as we live. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the Kyrie. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Blessed Lord, you have caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning. Grant that we may so hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue with our readings from Scripture. Our first reading is taken from 2 Chronicles, chapter 28. The men of Israel took captive 200,000 from their fellow Israelites, including women, sons, and daughters. They also took from them a lot of spoil and brought it to Samaria. There was a prophet of the Lord whose name was Oded. He went out to meet the army that came to Samaria. He said to them, "Look, because of the anger of the Lord, the God of your fathers, with Judah, he gave them into your hand. You have killed them in a rage which has reached up to heaven. Now you are intending to subjugate the people of Judah and Jerusalem as male and female slaves for yourselves. Do you not have your own sins against the Lord your God? Now hear me. Send back the captives whom you have taken from your brothers, because the fierce anger of the Lord is upon you. Men from the leaders of Ephraim, Azariah, son of Johanan, Berechiah, son of Mehishlemoth, Jezekiah, son of Shallum, and Amasa, son of Hadiel, took a stand against those returning from the war. They said to them, "You must not bring the captives here, because the guilt against the Lord is upon us. You are proposing to increase our sins, our guilt, and the fierce anger against Israel. So the armed men left the captives and the spoil before the officials and all the assembly. The men who have been mentioned by name got up and took over the captives, all of them who were naked, they clothed from the spoils. They clothed them, gave them sandals, provided them with food, gave them something to drink, anointed them with lotion, and transported the feeble on donkeys. They brought them to Jericho, the city of palm trees, to their fellow Israelites. Then they returned to Samaria. This is the word of the Lord. Our reading from the Holy Gospels is taken from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 23. Turning to the disciples, Jesus said privately, "Blessed are the eyes that see what you see. Indeed, I tell you, that many prophets and kings wanted to see the things that you are seeing, yet did not see them, and to hear the things that you are hearing, yet did not hear them." Just then, an expert in the law stood up to test Jesus, saying, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "What is written in the law?" Jesus asked him. "What do you read there?" He replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself." Jesus said to him, "You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But he wanted to justify himself, so he asked Jesus, "And who is my neighbor?" Jesus replied, "A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among robbers, who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. It just so happened that a priest was going down that way, but when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. In the same way, a Levite also happened to go there, but when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. A Samaritan, as he traveled, came to where the man was. When he saw him, he felt sorry for the man. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them. He put him on his own animal, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, when he left, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, 'Take care of him. Whatever extra you spend, I will repay you when I return.' Which of these three do you think acted like a neighbor to the man who fell among robbers?" "The one who showed mercy to him," the man replied. Then Jesus told him, "Go and do likewise." This is the word of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen. As we go through this pandemic, many things in the church's calendar are sort of up in the air. Whether we'll have it or we'll not, we're not really sure at this point. A couple of things are pretty sure. We are pretty sure that, barring another shutdown, that we will definitely be having worship on December 24th and December 25th. We're not going to miss Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. We will make that happen. And also, we will not have events on the evening of November 29th or on the afternoon of January 3rd, because the National Football League has scheduled games those days between the Chicago Bears and the Green Bay Packers. Living in the state line area, I suspect that more people will tune into those games in our area than even the Super Bowl itself. Now, I'm not from this area. I grew up in the Pittsburgh area, and so I don't really have any strong opinions about either team. And so I can easily say that I like the Chicago Bears and I like the Green Bay Packers, and I enjoy watching each of them. I've been to Lambeau, I've been to Soldiers Field. Now mention to me the Cleveland Browns, and that's a whole other story. In fact, in Pittsburgh, we don't even care for the Baltimore Ravens because they used to be the Cleveland Browns. But you know the rivalry that exists between Bears and Packer fans in this area, especially because we have a mixture of fans on both sides of the aisle, if you will. It is this kind of rivalry that existed in Jesus' day and in the centuries leading up to it between Samaritans and Jews. They were once one nation under David and then his son Solomon. But because Solomon worshipped other gods and did all kinds of other things that were detestable before the Lord his God, God took from his son Rehoboam 10 tribes of Israel. And so you had two nations. In the south, you had Judah and Benjamin with their capital in Jerusalem. And in the north, at Samaria, you have the capital of the rest of Israel. Because both nations continued to sin and worship other gods and did that which was detestable in the sight of the Lord their God, God gave them into the hands of their enemies. The first group to fall was the nation in the north at Samaria. They fell to the very powerful nation of Assyria. And then, 100 and some years later, the southern kingdom at Jerusalem, they too fell into the hands of what was the superpower of their day, the Babylonians. Now, how they handled the exile was different between these two nations. The northern nation intermarried with their captors and other people that were settled among them. And so that while they were descended from Abraham, they were also descended from many other peoples. Whereas the people of the south did not intermarry to any real extent among their captors or fellow captives. And so when both are returned to their respective lands, the people in the north do not trace their lineage exclusively back to Abraham, but back to Abraham, but back to other people as well. But for those in the south, they are proud to say that they trace their ancestry back to Abraham. They are true children of Abraham. Now, the people in the north also have changed up the religious practices a bit. Since they are not in the south where Jerusalem is, they have changed the game in where the temple should be and where the worship of God should be held. A centralized place of worship was commanded in the Old Testament at Jerusalem. But you see, our friends in the north, they only accept 5 books of the Old Testament, Genesis through Deuteronomy, and they do not accept the other books of the Old Testament as their southern neighbors do. And so they are rivals of a sort. They are cousins, if you will, but a lot of differences distinguish them from one another. And so they're rivals. You do things differently than I do, and I cannot stand that. But yet you claim to worship the same God. It's simply not true. And back and forth and back and forth. So that Jews traveling through Samaria, which they had to do quite a bit, anytime you went from the area in Judea, where Jerusalem is, to where Jesus is from, the hill country in Canaan, you needed to pass through Samaria unless you went a very inconvenient way. And most people did not. They would travel through Samaria, but they were careful not to touch anything. They would not eat anything along the way because these people are heretics. They have nothing to do with them. Just get where you need to be. And the way they looked at Samaritans who entered their land was just appalling. It would be like somebody walking around Green Bay in a Chicago Bears jersey. Or there you are in your Green Bay jersey riding the L down in Chicago. Sort of an unwanted, an undesirable, if you will. But the truth is, the comparison between the Bears and the Packers really doesn't draw out the intensity of their hatred for one another. Instead, if we look at the animosity that exists today between Democrats and Republicans, between these two parties, now you're starting to get a sense of the passion, the passionate hatred that existed between the two. Can you imagine if I were invited to go to a gathering of Republicans, and I have no idea why they would invite me. I'm not a member of either party. But let's say I'm there, and I decide as my opening illustration for my talk, whatever the talk might be, that I'm going to tell a story in which I paint Republicans as mean and rude people, people that have no sense of compassion. And then I get to the place in the story where a hero is needed. And the hero is a loving and wonderful Democrat. How long do you think I would remain in that gathering? Do you think I would get to the rest of my narrative? Highly unlikely. This is the setting in which Jesus tells the parable of the Good Samaritan. You and I, we hear the parable of the Good Samaritan, and we have warm memories of being in Sunday school classes or vacation Bible school in which we learned this passage. But it's divisive, it's scandalous. And I want us to have a sense of that context as we look at the parable this day. So what's going on here is Jesus and his disciples are sitting around and he is teaching them. They're in a gathering of sorts, but he's teaching them privately. But in the ancient world, privately does not mean necessarily secluded. You can gather with people, but that doesn't mean other people aren't going to gather around you. Even if you go indoors, there's no plate glass in those days. There's no pane glass windows. And so people can still kind of hang out at the windows. You're never really alone unless you really are in a secluded area, which is why sometimes we will see Jesus takes his disciples to a desolate area, or when he is wanting to pray, he will go off into a desolate area. So there they are, he's teaching his disciples, but there are other people sitting around. That's just the way it is in those day and age. There was no television, no Nintendo, no Xbox, and so they were interested. They want to see what's going on. So Jesus is teaching away, teaching his disciples, and suddenly, we read at verse 25, just then, an expert in the law, this is somebody who knows his Old Testament, he stood up to test Jesus. Now, the business of standing up, this is respectful decorum when you're before a rabbi. You don't act like you're at the same level as the rabbi by just sitting there and throwing a question at him. You stand in reverence and you present your question. But this guy really isn't looking to ask any questions. He wants to put Jesus to the test. Now, testing someone is very neutral in its basic language. This is what teachers do with students all the time, to check for understanding, to make sure that the students are learning what the teacher is teaching. But you know yourself, there's also a negative connotation. And the last time this phrase shows up in the Gospel of Luke, it's in chapter 4, when Jesus is out in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights fasting, and the devil comes to put him to the test. And so you and I, the reader of Luke's Gospel, we're put on notice immediately that this guy is up to no good, wanting to test Jesus. He said, "Teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, D.A. Carson, in a brilliant lecture on this passage, reminds us that at face value, or even at a deeper level, the question doesn't make a whole lot of sense. It doesn't make much sense. Because if you understand inheritance, what must I do? Does it make any sense? He is, as Carson says, mixing his categories. Inheritance is something you simply receive because you're a part of the family. You don't have to do a whole lot of things in order to inherit. You simply need to be a part of the family, and that's not really something that you do. It just is. And so really what he's doing here, he's throwing Jesus a curveball. And Jesus throws it back to him and says, "Here, why don't you try to hit it?" And so Jesus says to him, "What is written in the law?" Because that's the authority that they appeal to. What's written in the Bible? What does the scripture say? He says, "What do you read there?" There was a curveball back to him. The man replies, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind." Simply the first commandment, Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5. And then he adds in, this is interesting, he adds in Leviticus 19, 18, which, as you know, in your reading from Mark 12, when Jesus is asked about the greatest commandment, he gives the first commandment. And it's very clear to us why he does this, because if you were able to keep the first commandment completely, you would have no sins. Anytime we sin, we break the first commandment, we are de-godding God. We are saying that I will be God, I will call the shots. But Jesus says, I'm going to give you a second one too. And he gives them Leviticus 19, verse 18, and love your neighbor as yourself. So the man, conceivably, is a student of Jesus in some way. He's been around enough to know how Jesus has answered the question about what is the greatest commandment. And so he answers in the same way. Although, it's interesting because it's not the same question. Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? What is the greatest of the commandments? This guy has asked a bizarre question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? It's a nonsensical question because the categories are just wrong. But this is his answer. Jesus said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. Now what sounds to us like Jesus is saying, good job, excellent answer, well done. No, not at all. It's a rebuke. It's a rebuke. What the man has just done, he's taken a ridiculous question and answered it with something that cannot be done. We cannot love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our strength, all our soul, all our mind, and love our neighbor as ourself perfectly. And you see, the law of God is not subjective. It's not an essay question. It's a yes or no, a true or false. It's black and white. You either do it or you don't. Keeping the law a little bit is not keeping the law. And so this guy presents something that no one can do. And here's my answer. The scriptures say, do this, and you'll inherit eternal life. Jesus kind of shaking his head. You know how you put in your Facebook, SMH. Shakes his head and he says, well, that is what the law says. Do that, and you will live. I can't argue with that logic. Good luck with that. Now, most people would be red in the face, and they would sit down. They would quit while they're behind. Not this guy. I love this guy. Here he comes again, wanting to justify himself. See, the text is telling us that Jesus wasn't saying, bravo, good job, chap. But it was a rebuke, because now the man, he wants to justify himself. He's going at Jesus again. He's been slapped down, and now he's going to go at him again. So he says to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Thinking is putting Jesus on the spot. It's another dumb question. Who is my neighbor? Look around you. You'll see your neighbor. It's not rocket science. But he wants to see if he can trap Jesus into either excluding someone that should be included or including those that they can rightly exclude. Jesus begins by telling the story. And as I say, this story is scandalous in the way Jesus tells it and because of its content. And so as you hear this story, remember that everybody is sitting on the edges of their seat. There's tension in the crowd as Jesus tells this story. So Jesus says, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. He fell among robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. This is really not that shocking. Falling into the hands of what they called highwaymen in those days was actually quite common. That's why you would always travel in groups, and you would never travel at night. But he's leaving Jerusalem. He's on his way to Jericho, on the Jericho Road, if you will. And he gets mugged. Take everything he has, beat him that he's half dead, and they leave him laying there naked. without any means of getting help. But Jesus says, have no fear. Someone comes along. And so, remembering all those cowboy movies we watched as kids, we think, we're saved. The people in the white hats are coming along. No, not really. Not really. We read that it just so happened that a priest was going down that way, a religious leader. But when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. And we're surprised by this. We say, what? This guy, he's bleeding, stripped of all clothing, he's laying, he's going to die. This priest just sees him and continues on his way. Now, there are some scholars who will want to rehabilitate the reputation of the priest. They say, well, but wait a minute. You know, the guy is a priest. What if the guy is dead? He doesn't know if the guy's dead or half dead. And he touches him. Now he's polluted himself. He's no longer clean. He can't exercise his duties in the temple. The worship of God would suffer. Yeah, that's lame. It just is. A couple of things are going on here. The first thing is that there were thousands and thousands of priests. He's not the only guy. For example, if I test positive for COVID and I need to quarantine for 2 weeks, St. John's isn't left without a pastor. One of my brother pastors or a couple of my brother pastors will see to the needs of our parish during my time of quarantine. I'm not the only one. In the same way, there are thousands of these guys. A priest is simply somebody who is male and descended from Aaron. Aaron lived a long time ago. And so there are a lot of them because Aaron was made a priest. And God decreed that his sons would be priests. And his sons' sons and their sons and their sons and their sons and their sons would be priests. And so there are tons of these guys. And so what happens is they live in their homes wherever they live throughout Israel, and they come to Jerusalem to serve for what is believed to be like 2 week stints, sort of like the National Guard, if you will. And this guy isn't on his way there. Not on his way there. Because we read that this man is going down from Jerusalem. And I don't care where you are in the world. In the language of the Bible and in the language of the people of that day, you always go up to Israel. I'm sorry, always go up to Jerusalem. If you are on Mount Kilimanjaro and you're planning a trip to Jerusalem, you will say to your companions, I am going up to Jerusalem. Doesn't matter where you are. Jerusalem is always up. So he's leaving Jerusalem, this man who is mugged. And so somebody happens by on that same way. He's a priest. He's done. He's going home. He's going home. Uh-oh. If he touches the dead body, what happens? Well, he's bought himself another week in Jerusalem. He'll have to delay his return trip by a week. He'll have to return to Jerusalem, and there he will go through ritual washings in order to become clean again, to be purified under the law, if you will. So what's at stake when the priest sees this man? Being inconvenienced. What's at stake for the man lying in the ditch? Life and death. There's no rehabilitating this man's reputation. And then Jesus says, in the same way, a Levite also happened to go there, a priest assistant, basically. Same thing, but when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. They're deadbeats. That's how they look. And everybody's sitting there listening, and Jesus is thinking the same thing. Oh my goodness. Because you can say, hey, come on, these guys, they're important people, and blah, blah, blah. But the story has already caused you to put yourself in the position of the man laying naked in the ditch, dying. And so you're thinking, wow, that's me in the ditch. I don't like that at all. Boy, these guys are uncaring. Now he cranks up the heat. He says, a Samaritan. It's almost a dirty word to say among Jesus' people. He says, a Samaritan, as he traveled, came to where the man was. When he saw him, he felt sorry for the man. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine on them. And this was actually a decent thing to do. They didn't even understand why this worked, but the wine, the alcohol and the wine would help to cleanse, clean things in a sanitary way. The alcohol kills germs. They didn't know about germs. And then the oil, they knew that the oil would soothe things. So he does the best that he can when he's out there, and he puts him on his own animal. And he took him to an inn and took care of him. There were no hospitals in that day. If you had somebody that needed medical care, you might seek out somebody skilled in medical arts, but there was no local central location to take them. He takes them to an inn and he pays the room and board and takes care of this guy. But he can't stay there forever. In fact, the next day, when he left, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, "Take care of him. Whatever extra you spend, I will repay you when I return." Now, if you're running an inn in those days, you are dependent upon people coming to your inn and staying in your inn. And it's nice if a lot of guests come and they stay and they don't tear the place up, and when they leave, they pay you and the next group of guests come in. But you're not that concerned about customer service. What we see in hotels today is quite removed from the inns of that day. But the Samaritan cares about this guy who he found left for dead. And so he says to the innkeeper, "Here's 2 denarii. This will last quite a while, actually, for lodging. But he wants more out of this guy. But he knows that if he doesn't offer him money, it's not going to happen. So he says, take care of him." And of course, in that context, the innkeeper's like, "What do I look like? Take care of him. I'm running an inn. You want to use a room? Use your room." But he says, "Take care of him. And whatever more you spend, whatever extra it costs, I'll pay you when I return." You see the dollar signs flashing in the innkeeper's eyes. I help this guy out, I take care of him, and I can bill this other guy who obviously has lots of money for whatever it costs. "Yes, stay in the room. What can I do for you? Can I change your bandages?" All these kinds of things. See how the Samaritan provides for him. The people in that crowd, maybe not Jesus' disciples, they're probably shaking their heads saying, "Whoa, this is bad PR. But everybody else, they're seething with anger. How dare you tell a story in which the bad guys are our most exalted people in society, while at the same time telling us the good person is some Samaritan?" And so Jesus turns back to the man. Remember, the question is, who is my neighbor? And Jesus tells this parable, but just as in the first case, the man asked the question, Jesus took the curveball, threw it back to him, and said, "Here, you try to hit it." He says, "What is written in the law? What do you read there?" Now he's going to throw another question back to the man. He tells this story, and then he says to him, "Which of these three do you think acted like a neighbor to the man who fell among robbers?" I love his answer. You know, he has no choice. The story doesn't leave any alternative but to say the Samaritan. But he's not going to say that. He says, "The one who showed mercy to him." Can't even choke out the words, "the Samaritan." "The one who showed mercy to him." You see, Jesus has turned the question upside down. He didn't ask the same question back to the man. The man said, "Who is my neighbor?" He said, in this story, who was a neighbor? Who was a neighbor? And the man has to say, well, this guy was a neighbor. So the question is not who should be included or excluded, but how shall we serve our neighbor? And it's very clear with mercy and compassion. And so Jesus says to him after he replies, the one who showed him mercy, go and do likewise. Go and do likewise. What's interesting is if we pay close attention to how Jesus' parable, his story unfolds, he is actually answering the first muddled question that came out of this guy who wanted to test him. This muddled up question, confused categories. What must I do to inherit eternal life? How do you earn inheritance? Jesus actually gets right back to it, circles back. When he says to him, basically, through the telling of this narrative, you and I see through the telling of this narrative that the answer is nothing. There's not a thing we can do to inherit eternal life. It's completely found within mercy, within God's mercy, that you and I, whether we identified from the start with the man laying in the ditch or not, you and I, as we read the whole of the New Testament, teaches us very clearly that we are that person. We are that person laying in the road. What does Paul tell us in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1? You were dead in your trespasses and sins. Dead people are unable to cooperate. They can do nothing for themselves. So here is a man laying in the ditch. And so, a priest, someone who mediates the religious beliefs and practices of his time, and a Levite after him. What do they offer the man? Nothing. Nothing. Can you or me? I should have said I, but what's a little grammar here or there? Can we love the Lord our God with all our heart, all our strength, all our soul, and all our minds? Love our neighbor as ourselves? Or do we fall short? And we do. We have the Word of God. We have the commands and the demands of God. But they are of no help to those who are dead in their trespasses. They cannot make us alive again. And then someone from the outside comes in. The Samaritan. Who's the Samaritan in this narrative? It's Jesus. He is the true good Samaritan. Just as he is the true good shepherd. And he comes along to us in that state, because the man laying in the ditch, in this story, he's not dead. But the priest and the Levite really don't know that. But at the end of the day, if the Samaritan hadn't come along, he would have been dead. He would have died. You and I, the same is true. Apart from Jesus, even though we know what the law commands, what the commands and the demands of God are, we would die in our trespasses. Every single day of our lives, we are in hell by what we do and what we fail to do. And Jesus comes along, and he bandages the man, cares for him, puts him on his own animal. In the same way, Christ Jesus has taken our sins upon himself, just as the man in the story puts the man up on his own animal. Jesus takes up our burden, our sins which stand between us and God, and he bears them to the cross. And just as the man in the story provides for the care and nurture of this man, that he doesn't die, the Lord Jesus Christ gives his word, the law, the commands and the demands of God, but also the precious word of the gospel, that he has died in our place and answered for our sins. He gives his word, and he gives baptism. It's a command. Jesus says, make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all I have commanded you. And he also says, after he took the bread and he takes the cup, he says, do this in remembrance of me. He gives the word and the sacraments that just like the man being cared for in the inn, our faith may be strengthened, nourished, and alive until he returns, as the Lord has promised to return for us. He says to his disciples later at the Last Supper that I go away, but when I come again, I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. The point of the parable is not, if you want eternal life, you got to act like the Samaritan. Then our categories are mixed up. We receive it as an inheritance. It's given to us because in Christ, in our baptism, we have been adopted by the Father, made daughters and sons of the Father, sisters and brothers of Christ. We're a part of the family. So we don't earn this inheritance. You can't. But it's freely given. And as our hearts are transformed by this precious message, this word of grace, this gospel truth that has the power to make alive, it's the law, the commands, the demands of God which kill us, reduce us to nothing. But that gospel message that Christ Jesus has died for all of those sins, it makes alive, it raises the dead, and God has done so for you. As your heart is transformed by the message of this gospel, what will happen is you will find yourself doing as the Samaritan does. Trusting in Christ, you will find yourself doing the things that Christ does, living as a member of the family. But your place in the family isn't defined by what you do. What must I do? It's defined by who you are. A member of the family, made so in baptism, as the Holy Spirit has caused you to believe and continues to nurture that faith, continuing to keep you into the family, until, like the Samaritan who's gone farther on his trip, the Lord Jesus comes again to take you to himself into eternity. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Good to me, his word my hope secures. He were my shield and portion me as long as life endures. My chains are
Let us together confess our faith in Father, Son, Holy Spirit, in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. The third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Song again, whatever.
whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like worship Your holy name. Bless You, time has come. Still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Come on. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Worship Your holy name, Lord, I worship Your holy name. Sing like never.
Please join me in praying the prayer taught by our Savior Jesus Christ. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and all people, according to their needs. For the Holy Christian Church throughout the world, and for all who confess the name of Christ, that God would guard and defend us from the temptations of the devil, the world, and our sinful nature, let us pray to the Lord. For this congregation, its mission, and its people, for the ability to meet the needs that arise as we do the work God has given us to do, and for the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, let us pray to the Lord. For those who have wandered from the faith, that the Holy Spirit would use us to call them home to the Father, let us pray to the Lord. For the government and all who have been set into positions of leadership, that they may use the authority entrusted to them honorably and for the good of the people. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who serve in worthy occupations, professions, arts, and sciences, that God would grant them skill and integrity in the performance of their responsibilities and valued service through their vocations. Let us pray to the Lord. For those who suffer from hunger, homelessness, poverty, or unemployment, that God's great mercy and love would preserve and relieve them, let us pray to the Lord. For all the faithful, that the Spirit would lead them to cheerful, generous giving from the bounty the Lord provides to support the church and to help those in need, let us pray to the Lord. For those who are sick, especially those whom we have named on our prayer list and those whom we now name in the thoughts of our hearts. That God would grant healing to their bodies and strength to bear their infirmities with patience and grace, let us pray to the Lord. For those who mourn, that in their time of sorrow, they would not lose hope, but rely on God's promise that He will never leave them or forsake them. Let us pray to the Lord. For those who rejoice in the rich blessings of God, that they may always remember the giver of every gift and give Him heartfelt thanks, let us pray to the Lord. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.